know about a sound now?
Shabbat Shalom. My name is Yadon Yasharal, and I'm with my brother Yonatan Yasharal. And the title of today's Shabbat sermon is The Angels Before You. The Angels Before You. And what we don't take in consideration sometimes is that the angels, the messengers, the watchers, they behold all that we do. They behold all that we do. And the angel's job is also to keep us in the way, to ultimately have Yah's will to be done on the earth as it is in heaven. And if that means he has to slay you or chasten you or slay someone else, which is causing a problem in your life, he will get that done. So we're going to get a little bit of understanding about these malakim that be before us, and understand how we are to walk and using them, being that they're spirits, to help us put Yah's will in our lives as well. So we're going to open up in Shemot chapter 23, Exodus chapter 23, and we're going to start that at verse 1. Exodus, Shemot, chapter 23, and again, the title of today's Shabbat sermon is The Angels Before You.
You shall not raise a false report. Put not your hand with the wicked to be an unrighteous witness. You shall not follow a multitude to do evil, neither shall you speak in a cause to decline after many to wrest judgment. Neither shall you countenance a poor man in his cause. If you meet your enemy's ox or his donkey going astray, you shall surely bring it back to him again. If you see the donkey of him that hates you lying under his burden, and will forbear to help him, you shall surely help with him. You shall not wrest the judgment of the poor in his cause. Keep you far from a false matter, and the innocent and righteous slay you not. For I will not justify the wicked.
Interesting happened to me. Thing happened to me while I was out of town. I had an old book bag that one of the other salespeople that used to work with the company had. So the company gave it to me, and they checked it and they took the stuff out of it. And when I was out of town, I found a wedding ring in the actual book bag, and it was a gold wedding ring, 14 karat, nice and. I put it on, it fit and everything like that, and I was like, wow. So, I brought it home, and, of course, my mind crossed, and I wondered how much this thing is worth.
Right.
But I'm saying, this is somebody's wedding ring. This is something sentimental to somebody else. Even it could fit me just as well. I got a wedding ring already. Right. But the first thing that came up in my mind was this commandment here. If your enemy's ox is going down the way, you're supposed to return it. I don't even know this sales guy. He's not my enemy. Mm-hmm. So how much more wicked is it when you don't even know the person, deeds or anything like that, for them to be an enemy to you and you keeping it?
That's right.
Go ahead, bro.
Keep what it is.
Verse 8. And you shall take no gift, for the gift blinds the wise and perverts the words of the righteous. Mm-hmm. Also you shall not oppress a stranger, for you know the heart of a stranger, seeing you were strangers in the land of Egypt, Mizraim. And 6 years you shall sow your land, and shall gather in the fruits thereof. But in the seventh year you shall let it rest and lie still, that the poor of your people may eat. And what they leave, the beasts of the fields shall eat. In like manner you shall deal with your vineyard and with your olive yard.
And this is the law that, because the wicked are in power, does not get enacted. So the land is constantly used and abused, and because of that, it cannot produce the blessings that it's supposed to produce. So the angel got to come and destroy stuff. So the land is moaning and groaning, taking all this punishment because of the people of the land being defiled. And it's like, man, when are the saints going to be ruling? When are the righteous going to rule so that I can get some rest too? So that I can produce the fruit that I want to produce and be the glory and the blessing that Yah designed for it to be in the beginning. Go ahead, brothers.
Verse 13. Verse 12. 6 days you shall do your work, and on the seventh day you shall rest, that your ox and your donkey may rest, and the son of your handmaid and the stranger may be refreshed. Mm-hmm. And in all things that I have said unto you, be circumspect, and make no mention of the name of other gods, mighty ones, neither let it be heard out of your mouth. Mm. 3 times you shall keep a feast unto me in the year. You shall keep the feast of unleavened bread. You shall eat unleavened bread 7 days, as I command you. And in the time of the appointed month Abib, for in it you came out from Mitzrayim, and none shall appear before me empty. And the feast of harvest, the first fruit of your labors, which you have sown in the field, and the feast of ingathering, which is the end of the year, which is in the end of the year, when you have gathered in your labors out of the field. 3 times in the year all your males shall appear before the sovereign Yahweh. You shall not offer the blood of my sacrifice with leavened bread, neither the fat of my sacrifice remain, neither shall the fat of my sacrifice remain until the morning.
So you shall not offer the blood of my sacrifice with leavened bread. And we understand that leaven represents sin. So as we become part of that perfect sacrifice, which is Yahshua, the perfect sacrifice, we are not to have that leaven, that sin within us. And this practice of unleavened bread is a time for us to reflect and a time for us to practice that carnal mind frame of removing the leaven, getting everything, getting prepared to come before the Father to make this presentation, which is going to happen on the first fruits, which is a holy day separate for itself to make a offering unto Yahweh. But you also have an offering that also happens on unleavened bread as well. Go ahead.
Verse 20. Verse 19. The first of the first fruits of your land you shall bring into the house of Yahweh your Elohim. You shall not see the kid in his mother's milk.
Now, the first of the first fruits of your land you shall bring into the house of Yahweh your Elohim. So that means you also have the first fruits of your land that is grown after the year starts. You also had the first fruits of land of your land that was grown in the old year that's left over. So there's a difference between the two. Go ahead.
Behold, I send an angel before you to keep you in the way and to bring you into the place which I have prepared. Beware of him and obey his voice. Provoke him not, for he will not pardon your transgressions, for my name is in him.
So Yah sends an angel before us, a spirit, a comforter, somebody to guide us and keep us in the way, to help us understand the letter of the law, but also apply the spirit of the law, so that he can guide us all the way through this endurance race so that we can come into our inheritance. But we have to be mindful of him, beware of him, obey his voice. But how are we going to know the voice of the holy Kadesh Malachim and the voice of the evil Malachim? We have to do our own study as well. We have to study to show ourselves approved and at least have a children's understanding of the milk of this word. If you have at least understand the milk of this word, then you can decipher and you can know who to take counsel from and who to listen, whether it be a spirit or whether it be a spirit within a man. Go ahead, brother.
Verse 22. But if you shall indeed obey his voice and do all that I speak, then I will be an enemy unto your enemies and an adversary unto your adversaries. For my angel shall go before you and bring you in unto the Amorites and the Hittites and the Perizzites and the Canaanites and the Hivites and the Jebusites, and I will cut them off. You shall not bow down to their gods, nor serve them, nor do after their works, but you shall utterly overthrow them and quite break down their images.
So he warned us and he told us, listen, I'm going to put my angel, my spirit is going to be before you that has my name. These other spirits that don't have his name, they speak on their own accord. And then these dead idols that have no spirit at all, they're speaking on man's accord. Man is deciding that. The evil spirit that's in that man is deciding what he wants to do with that. So now when we decide, you know what? I'm not going to put my trust in Yah. I'm going to put my trust in a dead man or an idol or another person's opinion. You're basically saying, I don't trust the Father to lead me into the promised land. I need something other than Yah to help me get there, whether it be a man, whether it be a belief in another system, whether it be a bunch of people that are walking that direction. This is, in fact, what you're telling Yah. You cannot turn around and say, I serve Yah and I'm keeping the greatest commandment if you're serving Him and yourself and other dead idols. Mm-hmm. Go ahead, brother.
And you shall serve Yahweh your Elohim, and He shall bless your bread and your water, and I will take sickness away from the midst of you. There shall nothing cast their young, nor be barren in your land. The number of your days I will fulfill. I will send my fear before you, and will destroy all the people to whom you shall come, and I will make all your enemies turn their backs unto you.
So there's a number of days that we are allotted. But what happens is when we sin, when we commit these transgressions, we cut ourselves down. We don't get to fulfill those days. Just like where it says, you know, a child that dies is 100 years is like a baby, but a sinner dies at 100 years. Mm-hmm. Well, that's when the adversary is gone. Mm-hmm. We get to fulfill those. Now we're fighting the adversary, so he understands that it's a little bit harder for us to navigate through that. But if we understand this concept, we know that the offense is going to come, but it doesn't have to be by us all the time. Go ahead.
Verse 28. And I will send hornets before you, which shall drive out the Hivite, the Canaanite, and the Hittite from before you. I will not drive them out from before you in 1 year, lest the land become desolate and the beast of the field multiply against you. By little and little I will drive them out before you, until you be increased and inherit the land. And I will set your bounds from the Red Sea, even unto the sea of the Philistines, and from the desert unto the river. For I will deliver the inhabitants of the land into your hand, and you shall drive them out before you. You shall make no covenant with them, nor with their mighty ones. They shall not dwell in your land, lest they make you sin against me. For if you serve their gods, it will surely be a snare unto you.
All right. I wanted to look at something real quick. Where you said, I will send hornets.
29. What's that? 28.
Yeah, it says, I will send hornets. I wanted to look at the Hebrew real quick. Exodus
23:28. It's also in Deuteronomy and Yeshua also. Yeshua.
It's Sirah, H-6880, spelled T-S-I-R-A-H. And that's a wasp as stinging hornet. And the root word of it is tsara, which is to scourge, which is H-6879, which is spelled T-S-A-R-A. To scourge, that is to be stricken with leprosy. Leprous. So I thought that was very interesting. That when you get down to the root word of that, it's talking about leprosy and leper. And that's something that's a little deep, just to tarry on, to look. You know, I'm not going to speculate on that one, but...
What was leprosy again?
Leprosy is... Leprosy is when you get that discoloration of the skin, that you lose your melanin in your skin, and you get sores, and you get, you know, callousing over your skin, and you would be unclean. You wouldn't be able to do anything holy. You would basically be put away from your people. So, and ultimate, if you get down to the root of it, it's I will send people that are unclean. Or an uncleanness amongst you that will separate you from your people or from your spirit. Let's go into Bereshit chapter 28. Genesis chapter 28. You do yourself a disservice when you get in this book and you just try to read it from somebody else's translation and don't trust that the Spirit allows you to understand things or at least point things out for you to study on your own and to research and get into the Hebrew and understand the mind frame of our ancestors. We know that the language was scattered. Everybody was scattered. The language was changed for a purpose, for a reason, to keep us from doing wickedness. But we're trying to find our way back to that holy language. So we're in Bereshit chapter 28. And we're going to see an angel that is before you. An angel that is going to promise Yaakov that, hey, I'm going to lead you. I'm going to bring you into this inheritance.
And Yitzchak, Isaac, called Yaakov, Jacob, and blessed him and charged him and said unto him, you shall not take a wife of the daughters of Canaan. Arise, go to Paddan Aram, to the house of Bethuel, your mother's father, and take you a wife from there of the daughters of Laban, your mother's brother. And Almighty bless you and make you fruitful and multiply you, that you may be a multitude of people.
And he's telling him to go to his mother's father, you know, because it would be a different seed. You know, when you're talking about your father's side and your cousins on that side, that's of your seed.
Bloodline.
You know, that's closer to your bloodline. So, he obviously knows for the genetic reasons as well to prevent genetic diseases and problems go on that side. But at the same time, hey, listen, I know that family because I took your mother. I'm familiar with that. I know what they produce. Go ahead.
So, brother, would you make a distinction between, he said, thou shalt not take a wife of the daughter of Canaan, which is Hamite.
Right.
You know, we usually put African, but, you know, we know that the cotton of African houses many, you know, people, you know, but Hamite, because when you want to send him to Paddan Aram, you want to go to his people, which are Shemites.
Right.
You know, so I wanted to make that known when you establish the information of going to his mother's side of the family
right.
to get a wife, you know.
Right.
The Canaanites might make you, Canaanite woman might make you follow after another elk.
Exactly. And she's not going to understand your culture, and you're going to have the same issue that Moshe had, where, you know, you bloody man, you know, where Moshe almost got killed.
That's right.
They was about to kill him. You know, he had to make that decision. And interesting enough, these servants of Yah, that angel is waiting. Don't think because you a servant or you a leader that, you know, the angel is just pardoning you from all your stuff and letting you go. He's right there waiting to slay you because you're the leader. Because if you mess up, you cause all these people to mess up. So with Moshe, that angel was like, look, I'm going to kill. Yahweh was like, I'm going to kill you. And we're about to see the same thing with Yahshua or Oshea, the son of Nun. We're going to see that pretty shortly as well. Let me continue on. Go ahead.
Verse 4. And give you the blessing of Abraham to you and to your seed with you, that you may inherit the land wherein you are a stranger, which Elohim gave unto Abraham. And Yitzchak sent away Yaakov, and he went to Paddan Aram unto Laban, son of Bethuel, the Syrian, the brother of Rebekah, Yaakov and Esau's mother. When Esau saw that Yitzchak had blessed Yaakov and sent him away to Paddan Aram to take him a wife from there, and that as he blessed him, he gave him a charge, saying, you shall not take a wife of the daughters of Canaan. And Yaakov obeyed his father and his mother and was gone to Paddan Aram. And Esau, seeing that the daughters of Canaan pleased not Yitzchak his father, then went Esau unto Ishmael, and took unto the wives which he had, Mahalath, the daughter of Ishmael, Abraham's son, the sister of Nebaioth, to be his wife.
All right, so Esau went into Ishmael. Ishmael was the first son of Abraham. Mm-hmm. So with this carnal situation and all, Esau is white man, and it don't even make any sense. He went into Ishmael. First of all, he was the twin brother of Yaakov, and then he went into Ishmael.
Mm-hmm.
So this is now, you get Arab, which literally means mingled people. You can now see why they look like us, why you see Arab people that look just like us, mingled. So that whole doctrine of how did the people of the Caucasus Mountain get all, you know, just leave from out these caves and come all the way down at this time and become Esau?
Right.
It doesn't make any sense. Now, could they have adopted the spirit of Esau? Yes, they can.
Yes, they can.
Same way that they can adopt the spirit of Yah, the spirit of Yasharah, by grabbing a hold of these commandments. But you can't look at somebody and tell what spirit they grab. You have to see their deeds, and you have to see their deeds and compare them to these commandments so you can see what spirit they adopted. Because if you do the same thing, you look at a brother that looks exactly, it could be your own twin brother, your own fleshly twin brother. If he's not walking according to these commandments, just because he look exactly like, I mean, spit an image of you, does not mean that he's your brother spiritually. Go ahead, bro.
And Yaakov went out from Beersheba and went toward Haran. And he lighted upon a certain place and tarried there all night because the sun was set. And he took up the stones of that place and put them for his pillows and lay down in that place to sleep. And he dreamed, and behold, a ladder set up on the earth, and the top of it reached to heaven. And behold, the angels of Elohim ascending and descending on it. And behold, Yahweh stood above it and said, I am Yahweh, Elohim of Abraham, your father, and the Elohim of Yitzchak. The land whereon you lie, to give to you will I give it, and to your seed. And your seed shall be as the dust of the earth, and you shall spread abroad to the west, and to the east, and to the north, and to the south. And in you and in your seed shall all the families of the earth be blessed. And behold, I am with you, and will keep you in all places where you go, and will bring you again into this land, for I will not leave you until I have done that which I have spoken to you of.
So Yahweh is promising him that, look, I will lead you, I will bring you into this land. But he's going to do that by teaching you right from wrong, because you are guaranteed to go into this land. It don't matter who you are guaranteed to go into this land if you do righteous. If you do righteous, you reap what you sow. You're not going to plant a righteous seed and reap corruption. It doesn't work that way. If you do what you're supposed to do, you are going to get the right outcome. Just on the flip side, if you could be of the seed of righteousness, but if you decide, I want to take the spiritual seed of wickedness and want to do that my whole life, or I want to give up at the end because, you know, I'm good, I've done enough good deeds, you're going to reap exactly what you sow, because Yah is not going to be mocked. Go ahead.
Verse 16. And Yaakov awakened out of his sleep, and he said, surely Yahweh is in this place, and I knew it not. And he was afraid and said, how dreadful is this place? This is none other but the house of Elohim, and this is the gate of heaven. And Yaakov rose up early in the morning and took the stone that he had put for his pillows and set it up for a pillar and poured oil upon the top of it. And he called the name of that place Bethel. But the name of that city was called Luz at the first.
Luz. And Luz, I believe, is a derivative of light. Let's look at that. Genesis 28 and 19. Which is from 3869, as growing there, Luz, the name of two places in Palestine. So we need to look at the root word of that. And the root word of that is actually, it's probably a foreign origin, some kind of nut tree, perhaps the almond tree, hazel. H3869. So in the Hebrew it doesn't, but in Latin and those other words, luz or luz means light. Go ahead, bro. Finish it out.
Verse 20. And Yaakov vowed a vow, saying, if Elohim will be with me and will keep me in this way that I go, and will give me bread to eat and raiment to put on, so that I come again to my father's house in peace, then shall Yahweh be my Elohim. And this stone which I have set for a pillar, shall be Elohim's house. And of all that you shall give me, I will surely give the tenth unto you. All
right, so he made the promise that, listen, if you keep me in the way, you bring me into this land, you give me this salvation, the tenth of everything I have belongs unto you. So he made that covenant. That covenant is enacted in us, and we owe him that tenth. That tenth. Now, does he want a tenth of your salary? Is that what's important to him? Or is he more important to him as a tenth of your time? As a tenth of what you have to feed his children? Now, you can give him a tenth of your money, and that will be a sacrifice. But what are you going to do with that? He would take the money, and he would turn around, and he would benefit the poor. That's why he said, you're going to leave the outside of your fields so that can be reaped. So this tithe is in effect before Aaron and before all these things are happening.
And also, brother, the tithe, like you said, went to the servants of the temple and the poor.
Exactly.
And the disenfranchised, fatherless, widows,
the widows, all of that. Right. But instead, what do?
Become rich.
The pastors take of the widows, of the poor, of the fatherless, and they take that money, and instead of redistributing it, they keep it for themselves, right. and they raise themselves above their brothers and sisters.
They merchandise to the people.
Now, if you take some of the money, and you give away a little portion of that, but you're not taking care of the poor people in your community the way you could be doing, that's not going to be accepted. That's a flawed sacrifice. Mm-hmm. You say, we set up this scholarship fund for $5,000, and I gave two scholarships. $10,000. Man, you're going to make, some of these churches going to make $1 billion this Easter.
Oh, yes.
Literally.
Oh, yes.
The churches are going to make that much money this Easter. And you're going to give $10,000, $100,000. I don't care if you give $1 million away. That's nothing in comparison to what you could be doing to the poor, at least in your congregation.
Nothing.
But even besides that, why don't you give to people that are not giving to you? That would be a real sacrifice. What good is it if you're going to give to somebody that's going to give something right back to you?
Mm-hmm. And brother, to add to that transgression, the worst part about it is that we just read a while ago, it says, in all things I have said unto you, be circumspect and make no mention of the names of other mighty ones, other gods, neither let it be heard out of your mouth. But they have a whole festival dedicated to Ishtar.
Right.
Saying it. Easter. Right. It's Easter Sunday. What happened to not adding or taking away from Yah's word?
Right.
But you're going to add this false god and take away Passover. You're going to transgress all in one right there.
What are playing games? The one time that Easter is mentioned in here, if you look at the word that was there, is Pascha, which is the Greek for Passover. Mm-hmm. But Easter cannot be Passover.
That's right.
When you look at when it is kept, it cannot be in relation to the way Pesach is kept. The timing is off. Even the math is off. It lets you know, how do you get 3 days and three nights from Friday to Sunday?
Right.
It don't add up. So they don't care. They know people can count easily. But guess what? Those are the same people that look at that calendar and say Sunday is the seventh day of the week. Even though all of their calendars still say Sunday is the first day of the week. So they're not concerned with truth. Go ahead, brother.
I'm glad you brought that point up, brother, because I'm not going to really go into it right now, but I know I made I spoke on the same thing yesterday, and I made a little mistake on how I brought it over. I brought it over so hard that I injured a person. You know, even though I spoke truth, I injured a person. And I had to go and apologize because they didn't truly understand. They were in an emotional state about believing and seeing from a reenactment of how Yahshua was beaten for our sins, and the blood and so forth, and what they believed carrying a cross was a torture stake, a pole, But I tried to go a little further to let this person know that what's going to happen. You say you saw this yesterday. What's going to happen on your Easter Sunday? I said, basically, you're going to go get eggs and rabbits and have festivals and parties and stuff like that with these candies and stuff like that. What does that have to do with the resurrection or the sacrifice that Yeshua made, for our sins in obedience to his Father? You know, and they can't correlate that. You know, they don't realize by being blinded by the world, by these traditions that we were taught, that does not match. It does not go together. You know, I mean, when you giving, supposed to give glory, your heart is going out for the Messiah, for what he has done and the pain that he went through. So your heart is crying right now, and you feel emotional about that, and you're thankful to Yahweh doing that, you know, to his son for us. But yet you don't realize that you're sharing that holy day, that time, with the enemy by giving honor to another god, Ishtar, by a fertility god, by bringing a tainted food, a tainted offering to another god with his bunnies that don't lay eggs. You understand? And it's supposed to be called for fun, for Easter. And don't realize you're mashing those two together. So you're sharing that day. You're not honoring the Father. You're honoring two different Elohims. You understand? You're honoring God the Father, the creator of all. And you're honoring another spirit, an entity, Satan, the satanic spirit that you call Easter. So in mingling those two. So I apologize for not getting that point across most gently, you know, to a person that didn't understand that at all. But it's just that it's so deeply rooted in us, it gets my blood boiling sometimes to realize that how blind I was growing up in that area and how blind the world is still, not realizing, you know, how serious that point is, you know. So I'm glad that you brought that up, brother, you know, so it can be expounded to people who don't understand these things, you know, better.
There's a difference between somebody that doesn't understand and somebody that doesn't want to understand. This is 2016. People know that Easter has absolutely nothing to do with Christ, but they want to believe it, just like they know the Sabbath day is not Sunday. They'll tell you Sabbath day is not Sunday, but we keep it because that. Well, exactly. So you know this. So I don't have no kind of, you know, feeling sorry for them for how they, you know, for not understanding. No, it's a disobedience. If you haven't kept a Sabbath day all year, what makes you think that you're going to be able to keep a Passover, a real in spirit and truth? What makes you think you're going to be able to do that? So, yeah, in the way that we want to talk to them, they're babies, so we want to, you know, talk to them in a way that's not going to be, you know, too harsh. But at the end of the day, whatever, however you say it, it's going to deal with their emotions because of how they feel, because they're just purely acting on how they feel. And when somebody is about to fall into a walk in the middle of the road and get hit by a car, you can't walk to them and say, hey, excuse me, sir, you're about to get killed. Hey, calm down, you're about to get hit by a car. You go, whoa! You know, sometimes you got to do that. But in the end of the day, like I started off saying, if you haven't kept a single Sabbath day, you have no concern for any of the holy days, any of the Moadim, explaining to them that they need to be keeping, you know, the Passover, you're keeping Easter, and really at this point, all you're doing is really being a witness against them. Because if their heart hasn't been moved toward the spirit of truth, there's no light in them. They're not speaking according to the law and the testimony.
I concur with what you've stated on that. The only thing I wanted to add to that was this. As we're going through the process of getting the leaven out of our houses,
right,
we also have to learn how to get the leaven out of our personal heart houses.
Right.
And so what I was trying to contribute to that was that I didn't take into account, you know, of the way that I spoke, you know, with, even though I spoke truth, right, that I injured a person.
What was your intent?
My intent was to let them understand that, you know, what you saw, I understand that your heart went out to it, but understand that even though your heart went out to it, I'm trying to help you understand the truth of what's going to happen after. And then you can see the difference between what you felt for something that was real and then what you're going to feel 2 days later for something that's not real.
Right.
And you're not supposed to mingle those two. Sweet water and bitter water does not come out the same spit can. You know, so to me, by being a child of Yah, you know, is that I needed to check my own heart on how I handle things better.
Right.
Because I am supposed to be a witness of Yah. So I'm supposed to speak with intelligence, but also speak in love.
Right.
You know, and sometimes it does come down rough. You know what I mean? So I just wanted to bring that point up.
Right.
If I could chime in on what Brother Mikhail was expounding on here. When you get into this word, and you know, we all have seen the scripture where it says knowledge puffs up, things of that nature. But when you get into this word, you have to think, what shall this word be doing for me? And how is it going to help me help my people? Right. Is it going to cause me to bite and tear and injure my people?
Mm-hmm. Right.
Or is it going to cause me to warn them sternly, but you know, have compassion on them at the same time? You know,
right.
So I think we should look at what direction am I growing in? Because this food is feeding you.
Yes.
But is it feeding my pride? Like, right. Is it causing me to be like, all right, I'm right and everyone else is wrong, and whoever has the wrong thing, I'm just going to slice them down?
Right.
Is it going to make me grow in that direction, or is it going to make me grow in a direction where I'm going to feed
humble.
Y'all sheep?
Right. Right.
You know, while remaining humble and testing myself, because I think what we do sometimes, this is a mistake I've made as well, mm-hmm. you get into the word and you think this word is justifying you and the way you are.
Right.
But it doesn't. What it does is it's supposed to let other people know when you get it, you're proclaiming it. You're prophesying it to other people. You're professing it to other people. So as you're speaking this word to other people, it's not only for the others. It's for yourself as well.
That's right.
So make sure that as you're growing and you're eating, it's correcting you.
That's right.
And it's humbling
you
as well. And you're not going to put out something that you're not doing yourself.
That's what I'm talking about.
Right. And, you know, like how, you know, you guys will hear me say, at the end of the day, you know, the weightier matters of the law, judgment, mercy, and faith.
Yeah.
So if you're going to err on the side of mercy.
Yeah.
So if there was something in your heart, and this is where you got to be real with yourself. When you, because there's an anger that comes about with when there's
falsehood.
Evil and falsehood and transgression, because you're supposed to hate sin, but you're not supposed to hate the sinner.
Right.
So when you're talking to that person, you have to be real with yourself and say, am I now attacking this person because I dislike the sin? Or am I speaking the truth that is just so, you know, hot and on fire that there's going to be some tension level?
Mm-hmm.
And that's where you got to kind of check yourself. And if in your spirit you feel that I didn't come across correctly, it's probably because you're identifying something. And I've been there. And I do it myself. I'll identify it. Like, man, I was really just upset because of the sin that was happening.
Yes, yes.
And because I love that person and I see the direction they're walking, that I'm trying to attack that spirit, but the person that, you know, the baby that's sitting in front of us is taking the brunt of everything.
Yeah, getting beaten up.
So in that case, when you're in that scenario, we just want to be honest with ourselves, and that comes with your walk. It comes with your walk, because you also had times where Yahshua, you know, called Peter's Satan.
Yeah.
But at the same time, this was a disciple that was walking with him, learning with him. That's the difference between somebody out in the street.
Called a female dog.
But then Yahshua called a female dog. Because what's gonna be your ransom for sin? Because somebody told you something that hurt your feelings, so that means you can go ahead and transgress.
Uh-huh.
But at the end of the day, what is your intent?
Right.
If your intent is to save somebody, then you're going to figure out what it is you need to do to the best of your ability to get the job done. That doesn't mean that it's going to necessarily happen. But, you know, somebody kicking and screaming and they're drowning, then you want to swim and get behind them and try to save them so that they can't drown you.
That's right.
But that doesn't necessarily mean it's going to work. It doesn't necessarily mean it's going to work.
That's
so
right.
It's something that we got to pray about. And like my brother said, you know, you want to be compassionate, but you got to be honest with yourself as well. Go ahead, brother.
We finished
19, and we're going to start that at verse 1. Genesis chapter 19, and we're going to start that at verse 1.
And there came two angels, Malachim, to Sodom at even. And Lot sat in the gate of Sodom, and Lot, seeing them, rose up to meet them, and he bowed himself with his face toward the ground, and he said, "Behold now, my sovereigns, turn in, I pray you, into your servant's house, and tarry all night, and wash your feet, and you shall rise up early and go on your ways." And they said, "Nay, but we will abide in the street all night." And he pressed upon them greatly, and they turned in unto him, and entered into his house, and he made them a feast, and did bake unleavened bread, and they did eat. But before they lay down, the men of the city, even the men of Sodom, compassed the house round, both old and young, all the people from every quarter.
So angels eat.
And they called unto Lot, and said unto him, "Where are the men which came in to you this night? Bring them out unto us, that we may know them." And Lot went out at the door unto them, and shut the door after him, and said, "I pray you, brethren, do not so wickedly. Behold now, I have two daughters which have not known man. Let me, I pray you, bring them out unto you, and do you to them as is good in your eyes. Only unto these men do nothing. For therefore came they under the shadow of my roof." And they said, "Stand back." And they said again, "This one fellow came in to sojourn, and he will now be a judge? Now will we deal worse with you than with them." And they pressed sore upon the man, even Lot, and came near to break the door.
So he said, and they said, "Stand back." And they said again, "This one fellow came in to sojourn, and he will needs be a judge. Now will we deal worse with you than with them." And when you look in the book of Yashar, you see what the Sodom and Gomorrah was doing. They had wicked judges with these wicked laws that say, you know, you do this and do that, and automatically you get this judgment. Yet, how is the person supposed to know that this is the law? There's no clear posting. So this was the deeds that they did. And when you look at the laws in this country, it's very similar. They got all kind of laws that you would have no clue that was even in law. They'll pass things that you don't know about.
That's right.
And then when it comes about you, you not knowing has absolutely no excuse. But where it comes to the law of this book, it don't apply that way. Because everybody got access to this. This is the number one selling book in the country. And also one of the most banned books in the world. Go ahead.
Verse 10. But the men put forth their hand and pulled Lot into the house to them, and shut to the door. And they smote the men that were at the door of the house with blindness, both small and great, so that they wearied themselves to find the door.
And that's very symbolic. When you are so caught up in the flesh, and the desires of your flesh, regardless of how it pertains to righteousness, this is what will happen to you. A blindness will come over you. Go ahead.
And the men said unto Lot, "Have you here any besides son-in-law and your sons and your daughters, and whatsoever you have in the city, bring them out of this place? For we will destroy this place, because the cry of them is waxing great before the face of Yahweh, and Yahweh has sent us to destroy it." And Lot went out and spoke unto his sons-in-law, which married his daughters, and said, "Up, get you out of this place, for Yahweh will destroy this city." But he seemed as one that mocked unto his sons-in-law. And when the morning arose, then the angels hastened Lot, saying, "Arise, take your wife and your two daughters which are here, lest you be consumed in the iniquity of the city." And while he lingered, the men laid hold upon his hand, and upon the hand of his wife, and upon the hand of his two daughters, Yahweh being merciful unto him, and they brought him forth and set him without the city.
All right, so you notice that at the first he said, "I have two daughters that I have not known man."
That's what I was doing.
And then now it says his sons-in-laws, which married his daughters. So that means they were betrothed. They had not consummated that marriage, but yet they were still considered married. They were still considered a husband. Go ahead.
Verse 17. And it came to pass when they had brought them forth abroad, that he said, "Escape for your life, look not behind you, neither stay you in all the plain. Escape to the mountain, lest you be consumed." And Lot said unto them, O not so, Yahweh. Behold now, your servant has found grace in your sight, and you have magnified your mercy, and you have showed unto me in saving my life, and I cannot escape to the mountain, lest some evil take me and I die. Behold now, this city is near to flee unto it, and it is a little one. Oh, let me escape there. Is it not a little one, and my soul shall live? And he said unto him, See, I have accepted you concerning this thing, also that I will not overthrow this city for the which you have spoken. Haste you, escape there, for I cannot do anything till you be come here. Therefore, the name of the city was called Zoar.
So you have an angel of Yah that is leading you away from destruction and warning you not to turn back. Once you are given that choice of life, you can't turn back. You have to head that direction. The angel was going to bring them into safety, but he's deciding, Lot deciding, you know what? I'm going to walk before the angel. I don't want the angel to lead me. I'm going to lead the angel. I'm going to go where I want to go, and I'm going to have Yahweh bless me where I want to bless me. And you're going to see the results of him trying to make the decision. Mm-hmm. Now, we see what's going to happen to his wife. Who's to say that if they would have headed the direction at the time that they were supposed to go, then his wife may not have turned around?
Right.
Who's to say that? And who's to say what happened in the cave, which we're going to read, would have happened if he would have went the direction that the angel wanted him to go?
Right.
There could have been all kinds of things going on, wind blowing or whatever, that made people focus where they needed to focus. Or we don't know. But all we know is when you decide you want to do what you want to do, you fair game.
Mm-hmm.
Go ahead.
Verse 24. Then Yahweh rained upon Sodom and upon Gomorrah brimstone and fire from Yahweh out of heaven. And he overthrew those cities and all the plain and all the inhabitants of the cities and that grew upon the ground. But his wife looked back from behind him, and she became a pillar of salt.
So his wife, you cannot save everyone. And this is why Solomon says, if your wife or your husband is a non-believer and they want to dwell with you, don't push them out, because you don't know if they're going to change. But at the same time, if they want to leave and they're a non-believer, don't force them to stay.
Mm-mm.
Because who are you to think you can save your wife? Lot brought his wife out of destruction, away from the fire and the brimstone that was about to come down on this wicked city. And we were warned, don't turn back. Don't look back. But unless you're going to hold your wife's head and walk with her, whatever, you can't control that. And she looked back in her spirit.
Right.
She turned around and she was a pillar of salt. Go ahead, brother.
And Abraham got up early in the morning to the place where he stood before Yahweh. And he looked toward Sodom and Gomorrah and beheld, and toward all the land of the plain, and beheld, and lo, the smoke of the country went up as the smoke of a furnace. And it came to pass when Elohim destroyed the cities of the plain that Elohim remembered Abraham and sent Lot out of the midst of the overthrow, when he overthrew the cities in which Lot dwelt. And Lot went up out of Zoar and dwelt in the mountain, and his two daughters with him, for he feared to dwell in Zoar. And he dwelt in a cave, he and his two daughters. And the firstborn said unto the younger, Our father is old, and there is not a man in the earth to come in unto us after the manner of all the earth. Come, let us make our father drink wine, and we will lie with him, that we may preserve seed of our father. And they made their drink, they made their father drink wine that night. And the firstborn went in and lay with her father, and he perceived not when she lay down, nor when she arose. And it came to pass on the morrow that the firstborn said unto the younger, Behold, I lay yesterday with my father. Let us make him drink wine this night also, and go you in and lie with him, that we may preserve seed of our father. And they made their father drink wine that night also, and the younger arose and lay with him, and he perceived not when she lay down, nor when she arose. Thus were both the daughters of Lot with child by their father. And the firstborn bare a son, and called his name Moab, and the same is the father of the Moabites unto this day. And the younger, she also bare a son, and called his name Ben-Ami, and the same is the father of the children of Ammon unto this day.
So there's a lot of wickedness that went on in that situation. We saw already earlier in the story, they had not known a man. But yet they were betrothed to those two other men. So that means that they didn't sleep with their husbands yet. The husbands died, obviously. So that might have freed them up from that, as far as, well, maybe they'll be able to marry somebody else. But they're virgins. So now when you take a virgin, that's supposed to be your wife. So that's one issue. That's supposed to be your wife. And he's not marrying his daughters. He can't marry his daughters. So you got all these transgressions of the law going on here. A virgin you took, you're supposed to marry her. You can't marry her. That's one. Then it's your children, incest. You can't do that. That's two. Then you had a situation with sisters, marrying sisters while they're alive. So you got all this transgression going on. And how do those daughters know? Give him some wine. Yeah, that's his ransom for sin. Give him some wine and he'll do anything. Because I don't care how much wine you give me, I'm just going to pass out. That's not going to make me sleep with my daughters. There has to be something in here that says, you know what, that's the ransom for my sin. And we see that with people. That they got to go to the club and get wasted so they can have a ransom for their sin. And they have an excuse for doing, oh man, I was wasted. No, you just did what was already in your heart. So it was already in his heart that, hey, I don't care. My daughters are beautiful, or I'm just so, you know, I'm just such a type of individual that you give me a little bit of wine, and yeah, I'm fair game. So that shows you the state of that man's heart at that point, because that's pretty extreme. And he didn't do it once, he did it twice. Not in the same night, two different nights. So that lets you know what was in that man's heart.
And brother, the scripture that comes to my mind is like, even if you grind a fool with the mortar, you cannot separate his wickedness from him. You cannot separate his sin or his iniquity from him. So even though it was Yahweh's will to purge the sin from among the children of Yasharal, when Abraham asked, hey, can you just save Lot? It was like, if there's just one person, he was really just vouching for Lot. It doesn't necessarily mean that Lot was the most righteous one. Abraham just had some sort of favor toward Lot.
Right.
Whereas the children of Moab and Ammon ended up being one of the enemies of Yasharal to begin with. And then, even while Yahweh was trying to peel the wickedness, he had to peel the daughters from their wicked husbands, because as soon as Lot was like, hey, Yahweh's doing something, they laughed at him.
Right.
And then, so that whole situation was done. Then Lot took his wife, trying to grab onto his wife to take her out of the land. She looks back, and she gets put into the salt. Yahweh's just trying to peel away every aspect of wickedness.
Right.
And then right there in the cave, the wickedness happens again. So
right.
It's like how you left the children.
Took it with you.
Just like how you left the children of Yasharal to go to the mount to get the commandments, and you come back down and you're worshiping the calf.
Brother, it's just like when you go all the way back to the beginning with Adam and Eve. When she made that first son, Cain, that son was of the devil. It was of another spirit. And that same spirit destroyed his brother, who wanted to worship and faithfully worship Yahweh. So even though Yahweh didn't destroy Cain, because that sin was on the earth now, in the earth now, he had to make Seth to get things back on how you say it, spiritual seed.
Right.
You know, so this right here is just a deeper portion of that. Because if you think about it, look how foul this is. This is going even foul. You took a woman from this foul country, and why didn't you raise your family up in Yahweh? Because obviously, you know, with the sons that they was married, it was about to marry into that city, that wicked city, sons of that wicked city.
Right.
But why didn't you, you know, knowing Yahweh, take your family from that, when knowing your family is going to be enrolled into this wickedness? So it was inbred in his family now. So you was in trouble either way, because it was in your heart.
Right. And keep in mind
that
Moab is in the bloodline of the Mashiach.
Yeah.
You know, in King David. So, you know, everything obviously happened for a reason, but that just goes to show you that you can't change somebody. You can't save somebody.
No.
But ultimately, to begin with, Yahweh never said, you, your wife, and your nephew go to a place in which I will not know. But guess what? Because he was the bloodline of a righteous man, he had the opportunity.
Yes.
But Abraham couldn't give him the salvation. All you can do is give people an opportunity, like with your individual you spoke with. All you can do is give somebody the opportunity. The rest is on them. And ultimately, the rest is on Yahshua to decide if that's who he's calling unto them.
Mm-hmm.
But if we don't give the opportunity to somebody, then now it falls on us. Right. Because you didn't choose and decide who was going to be your nephew. Yah chose that and decided that. Just like the people around us, we don't choose who's in our family.
No.
We might be able to choose a wife, and even that, we think we're choosing that. We're not even really choosing that. So let's move on. We're going to go to Acts chapter 12. So you see, when you the results of when you decide that you're going to go where you want to go, well, now we're going to see a brother where an angel is going to lead him out of problems, and he's going to listen, and we'll see the benefit of that. Acts chapter 12, and we're going to start that at verse 1.
Now about that time, Herod the king stretched forth his hands to vex certain of the assembly. And he called Jacob. Killed Jacob, the brother of Yohanan, with the sword. And because he saw it pleased the Yehudim, he proceeded further to take Peter, Kepha also, and those were the days of unleavened bread. And when he had apprehended him, he put him in prison and delivered him to four quarternions of soldiers to keep him, intending after Passover to bring him forth to the people.
Right, so he read what was supposed to be there, Passover. But what they did in English, they wrote Easter to try to make you believe that it's the same thing. No, Easter ain't in there.
Mm-hmm.
They just translated it Easter, but it was Pascha. Pascha comes from Passover. Yeah. Pesach.
Pesach
has absolutely nothing to do with Easter, because they was keeping Easter well way before the Mashiach's time. And well after the Mashiach's time. Go ahead, brother.
Peter, therefore, was kept in prison. But prayer was made without ceasing of the assembly unto Elohim for him. And when Herod would have brought him forth the same night, Peter, Kepha, was sleeping between two soldiers bound with two chains, and the keepers before the door of the prison. And behold, the angel of Yahweh came upon him, and a light shined in the prison, and he smote Peter on the side and raised him up, saying, Arise up quickly. And his chains fell off from his hands. And the angel said unto him, Gird yourself and bind on your sandals. And so he did. And he said unto him, Cast your garment about you and follow me. And he went out and followed him, and knew not that it was true which was done by the angel, but thought he saw a vision. When they were past the first and second ward, they came into the iron gate that led unto the city, which opened to them of his own accord. And they went out and passed on through one street, and forthwith the angel departed from him.
So the holy Malachim freed this man from prison. He's walking past the guards. He's walking through the cell. That's got to be terrifying. Because if they catch you trying to escape, they're going to kill you. So he could have said, you know what? Nah, I'm just going to sit right here. Nah, you know what? Yeah, you can open that door, but when I open the door, I got to get past these guards. I got to get past these guards, and they're going to slay me. They're already looking for an excuse to slay me. But he had faith, and he listened to that angel. And what if the angel wanted him to slay, wanted him to die? What if that's Yah's will, then that's what it's going to be. You're going to die, because you saw what happened to Yohanan. He got beheaded. And you see, and they kill what, Yaakov or whatever? So if it's Yah's will that you die for righteousness' sake, that you be one of those 144,000 that are beheaded for the Mashiach, then that's his will. But at the end of the day, he's got work to do, and Yahshua is chosen him to go spread this word and to be the rock of his church. And to be the rock of his church means you got to move when that angel tell you to move. Because you're not just moving for you, you're moving for the whole assembly. Because the shepherd got to go out first and lead the rest of the sheep. So you can't have that spirit of fear and be afraid to move with the spirit because you're afraid of what might happen to you. Or you're afraid of who might not like you or listen to you or talk to you anymore. You can't be used that way. He can't use lukewarm.
Go ahead, bro.
Verse 11. And when Kepha was come to himself, he said, now I know for surety that Yahweh has sent this his angel and has delivered me out of the hand of Herod and from all the expectation of the people of the Yehuda. And when he had considered the thing, he came to the house of Mary, the mother of Yohanan, whose surname was Mark, where many were gathered together praying.
Living bread.
And as Kepha knocked at the door of the gate, a damsel came to hearken named Rhoda. And when she knew Kepha's voice, she opened not the gate for gladness, but ran in and told how Kepha stood before the gate. And they said unto her, you are mad. But she constantly affirmed that it was even so. Then said they, it is his angel. But Kepha continued knocking, and when they had opened the door and saw him, they were astonished.
So, first of all, you can see mixed doctrine here. They're saying, oh, they don't believe that he could be freed from prison. They don't believe in the power of the Mashiach, for one. Then you have, well, we will believe that a ghost would come. Because it is his angel. So when this man, where have we read that man dies and becomes an angel?
Nowhere.
So they got all this. This is what happens when you have this mixed doctrine and this Greek and this mixed beliefs. It will cloud your vision, and which is going to cloud your faith. Because you're mixing too many things together. Instead of seeking diligently in the matter and confirming. That would be an easy thing. Just go to the door. Who is this, brother? Nah. Mm-mm. Go ahead.
But he, beckoning unto them with the hand to hold their peace, declared unto them how Yahweh had brought him out of prison. And he said, go, show these things unto you. He said, that's Yaakov?
Yeah.
Yaakov and the brethren. He departed and went to another place. And brother, I think it's good to get this, the scenery of it, is that they're persecuting people who are worshiping the Messiah.
Right.
Or as we say, they're persecuting Christians.
Right.
You know, the newly converted Yehuda who believed in the Messiah, the followers of the way.
The Nazarene.
The Nazarene. Yes. Right. So they're in there, you know, secretly, you know, having their worship service, and they hear a knock at the door. And she heard the voice.
Right.
But she didn't want to open it. So she ran over, you know, she didn't want to make the mistake, like, okay, maybe it's not Kepha. Let me go tell him, like, yo, I think he's at the door. I'm like, man, you are crazy.
Right.
And then they're like, she's like, no, I think that's really him. We might have to open the door for him. Like, man, you gonna get us killed. We're just trying to eat this unleavened bread and just go home. You just always trying to do too much.
Right.
But, you know, as he kept knocking, they're like, wow, it's really you. So I think it's good to get that scenery that even to do the Passover was fought against.
That's right.
They try to change over now to Ishtar.
Right.
No, we're still going to try to keep this Passover.
Right. That's right.
So the same as then is the same as now. You don't fight to keep these commandments. Mm. It ain't going to be easy for you. The world's going to come against you, and there's going to be persecution. You're going to fight because when it was given to you freely, what did our ancestors do? They fought it. Yeah, they did it. They did it according to what it literally said. But then they added all these other things into it. And they removed the leaven from their hearts. So the same as now, the same as then is the same as now. You're going to fight. Now, is it as extreme as then? Where people is literally trying to kill you physically? No. That's why now is the time, while you have all this luxury to do this, is the time to learn how to do it and get in the habit of doing it so that if you're not doing it now, when nobody's trying to kill you, what makes you think all these people in these places going up and jump and start wanting to keep the Passover when people got infrared beams on you, looking for you, trying to kill you for keeping these commandments? And it's not far-fetched, because this book is literally banned in countries where they will kill you.
That's right.
It will kill you under Sharia law for these things.
Mm-hmm.
You got something, brother?
Just wanted to strengthen up what you were saying. It seemed like everything, how you say, repeats itself. And just like in the days gone by, you know, when you talk about Maccabees, you know, I mean, they literally kill people for keeping holy days or keeping the rites of what Yahweh said do, even when they had to circumcise their children. Mm-hmm. You know, you circumcise your children, they came and find out. They not only killed the child, but they mm-hmm. killed you too.
Threw them off, you know, off the
that's
wall.
Right. They murdered y'all. You know, so who's to say that when time comes that this is not going to happen again? You know, that they're going to search the children of Israel out to destroy you for keeping these laws there, because if you look around the world right now, they are actually trying to truly make one world religion, and everything goes along together. I saw on something on the internet yesterday when it was amazing to me. It was a 3-minute segment, and mostly Morgan Freeman in April was supposed to do Who is God? Right? That's the title. Or What is God?
Right.
And then you got all these people around the world answering the question, or trying to answer the question, who or what is God? And I didn't even hear one thing about Yahweh or all the people around the world that answered this question. And it was, I mean, you're talking about the people who answered the question had no idea. It's like they are so away from the meaning of what Elohim is, you know, the things that they stated. And only one person said, you know, that I can understand, at least I heard about, is Allah. You know, and you say Allah is the only God, but he said it's the same God as everybody else.
Right.
I'm like, see, this is that one world religion, one world belief, that everybody's belief, no matter what you believe in, is the same thing. You just got another name for it.
Right.
You see, so I can see that when we get down and we to this statement in here dealing with they're going to try and kill you, you got to hide to worship Yahweh. Because in your cellars and with your brothers and sisters, because you got hunters coming to destroy you because they're looking at you as a terrorist. I can see that coming later.
Right.
You know, before Yahweh frees us from this. You know? So it's a very good point, and I'm glad you said, yeah, look at this as a movie scene. Look at it as what is really happening here. You know, because this is probably what we probably be going through later.
I think the adversary found a new way of doing things, the easiest way of doing things, because what you saw, what you were, the Maccabees at that time, you had a whole bunch of brothers and sisters that they just said, no, we're not even going to fight. You will kill us on the Shabbat, and y'all going to see that we died for this. People will die for the religion. You see the Muslim people strapping bombs on themselves. This is right here in Brussels.
Oh, yeah.
Blowing themselves up. So people will die for their religion. That's not a problem. But will you give up pleasure?
Right.
Will you give up material things?
Mm, yeah.
Will you give up your comfort, your friends, and all that stuff for righteousness? And that's the stage we're at right now. You got plenty of people, you got gangsters in the street right now willing to die, you know, for red or blue or whatever. But are you willing to live for it? Are you willing to keep these commandments, give up the pleasures of this world for something that you may get in the future? That takes real faith. So that's the real test. And that's why we're not in that same situation right now. But oh boy, it talks about what's going to happen in the end. Mm-hmm. That's coming back. He gonna take the great tribulation. When that comes, all that pleasure stuff is gone. And now you got life too. So you're gonna be in spirit and in truth. You're gonna have to do it both ways. Go ahead and finish it out, bro.
Verse 18. Now, as soon as it was day, there was no small stir among the soldiers what was become of Kepha. And when Herod had sought for him and found him not, he examined the keepers and commanded that they should be put to death.
Mm.
And he went down from Judea to Sisera and there abode. And Herod was highly displeased with them of Tyre and Zidon. But they came with one accord to him, and having made Blastus the king's chamberlain, their friend desired peace, because their country was nourished by the king's country. And upon a set day, Herod, arrayed in royal apparel, sat upon his throne and made an oration unto them. And the people gave a shout, saying, it is the voice of a mighty one, a God, and not of a man.
Ooh.
And immediately the angel of Yahweh smote him, because he gave not Elohim the glory, and he was eaten of worms and gave up the spirit.
Mm.
But the word of Yahweh grew and multiplied, and Barnabas and Saul returned from Jerusalem when they had fulfilled their ministry and took with them Johanan, whose surname was Mark.
Now you have to ask yourself, how is he the king of Yasharon to begin with? He an Edomite.
Right.
You're not supposed to have nobody of another nation above you. And that's where this whole Jew came from. This Judaism and all that stuff came from around Herod, who made himself an Israelite by saying, no, the bloodline is determined by the woman.
Yeah.
So I'm going to marry me an Israelitess so that I can now be Israel. And that's that same lie they've been pushing the Gentiles just right in the book and said, oh, this is a loophole. Because that's how they think. Oh, I found a loophole.
Uh-huh.
And they made themselves, and that's what created this Jewish. Well, I'm like unto a Jew, because a Jew, per se, would have been like, you know, the Edomites that look like us, mm-hmm. but weren't us, and got in, and then they became Jewish. Well, I'm like unto the Jews that were married unto him, and said, oh, you know, this is how we gonna do. Mm-hmm. Never were we called Jews. We were never, ever called Jews. And you notice in here, they call it Judea. It's Yehuda.
Mm-hmm.
Let's go to Matthew chapter 2. So here you see again, this brother is free, and now he's the foundation of the church. Imagine if he didn't do that, stayed in there until Herod decided to kill him like he did some of the other brothers. Now we're going to see Yosef from Yehuda. We're going to see how he deals with this when the angel speaks to him. You can trust yourself or you can trust that spirit. If that spirit comes in the name of Yah. And you notice when them spirits come, they tell you. They'll tell you. The Elohim of your father, Abraham, Isaac, and Yaakov. And that's why when we pray, we letting them angels know this is where it's going. This is going to that father. Not to you, angel. Not to you, Malachim, that left your estate. This is going to the Elohim of Abraham, Isaac, and Yaakov. Matthew chapter 2. And we're going to start this at verse 1.
Now when Yeshua was born in Bethlehem of Yehuda, Judea, in the days of Herod the king, behold, there came wise men from the east to Jerusalem. So
how many men were there?
Wise.
It just says wise men, so we know there was at least two.
One, two, three, four were wise.
It was at least two. Where they get this three men from? Probably comes from Three Kings or whatever. I don't know. Probably tied to the Diva Triformis, which was the three goddesses that they kept, which led into this Trinity, this whole Trinity doctrine of three. If you look that up, Diva Triformis was Diana, Vesta, and or Vespa or something like three of them pagan goddesses.
Diva Triformis?
Yeah, Diva Triformis, and I guess they like that knowledge going out because my phone just randomly hung up.
Oh.
Wow.
Verse 2, saying, where is he that is born king of the Yehuda? For we have seen his star in the east and are come to worship him. When Herod the king had heard these things, he was troubled, and all Jerusalem with him. And when he had gathered all the chief priests and scribes of the people together, he demanded of them where Mashiach should be born. And they said unto him, in Bethlehem of Judea, for thus it is written by the prophet, and you, Bethlehem, in the land of Yehuda, are not the least among the princes of Yehuda, for out of you shall come a governor that shall rule my people, Yasharal. Then Herod, when he had privily called the wise men, inquired of them diligently what time the star appeared. And he sent them to Bethlehem and said, go and search diligently for the young child. And when you found him, bring me word again that I may come and worship him also.
Uh-huh.
Right.
When they had heard the king, they departed. And lo, the star which they had seen in the east went before them till it came and stood over where the young child was. When they saw the star, they rejoiced with exceeding great joy. And when they were coming to the house, they saw the young child with Miriam, his mother, and fell down and worshipped him. And when they had opened their treasures, they presented unto him gifts, gold and frankincense and myrrh. And being warned of Elohim in a dream that they should not return to Herod, they departed into their own country another way.
So they were warned of Elohim too. They were warned by the Spirit, by the angel, to not go that way. At least they would get in trouble as well. And notice, they were bringing gifts because he was the king. They weren't celebrating his birthday. They were giving gifts because this is when you don't show up before a king empty-handed. Just like when we make our offerings, we don't show up before Yahweh empty-handed.
That's probably
what they
get
to do
now. Go ahead. And when they were departed, behold, the angel of Yahweh appeared to Yosef in a dream, saying, arise and take the child and his mother and flee into Mitzrayim, and be you there until I bring you word, for Herod will seek the young child to destroy him.
So imagine they decide, nah, we ain't going nowhere. You know, I's comfortable here. My wife complaining. She, you know, she's her feet swole. She don't want to go nowhere. What would happen? Prophecies still would have got fulfilled. Things would have still got done, but there would have been a whole lot of problems. Mm-hmm. And I wanted to clarify that again as well about showing up empty-handed before the Father. The Father is a spirit. Mm-hmm. You can come with $100 in your hand and give it to a priest to be, you know, to take your offering for you. But if you are not coming with a spiritual offering to him, at least a tenth of what you can offer to him, it's not going to be accepted. So all well and nice, you know, a lot of the priests love this to use that as an opportunity to take money from people. But what is that doing for the individual if that individual feels like he's okay because he gave money? You're not doing your job. The only offering that is acceptable is a perfect offering. And the only perfect offering is the Mashiach. And the only way you can offer the Mashiach is if you are part of the Mashiach. The only way you can be part of the Mashiach is if you keep these commandments. Year round, not just when it's time to show up because you want to eat some Passover lamb. Go ahead, brother.
Verse 14. When he arose, he took the young child and his mother by night and departed into Mitzrayim, and was there until the death of Herod, that it might be fulfilled which was spoken of Yahweh by the prophet, saying, out of Mitzrayim have I called my son.
So he had to go because these things were prophesied. So he needed to go to Mitzrayim. He needed to go to Kemp. This had to be, this was prophesied that this was going to be done. So the angel said, this is what you need to do. So imagine if he said he didn't want to go. Oh, you going to go, bro. Mm-hmm. I'm going to make sure you go, whether you got to go in, you know, on a donkey with no legs, but you going to get there. Or you can let your wife sit on the donkey and you can walk there with your own two legs. Mm-hmm. But you going to go. Go ahead.
Then when Herod saw that he was mocked of the wise men, was exceeding wroth, and sent forth and slew all the children that were in Bethlehem, and in all the coasts thereof, from 2 years old and under, according to the time which he had diligently inquired of the wise men.
You think that angel gonna come back and tell Yahweh, hey Yahweh, I know our baby Yahshua got killed, but I mean, I try to tell him, he's hard-headed. You know how Yehuda is, man. The sword will never depart. You know how they are. He fought me. You know, I had, man, look, man, talk to Yosef. He don't listen. That angel gonna make sure that prophecy is fulfilled. Go ahead.
Then was fulfilled that which was spoken by Jeremiah, the prophet, saying, in Ramah was there a voice heard, lamentation and weeping and great mourning, Rachel weeping for her children and would not be comforted because they are not. But when Herod was dead, behold, an angel of Yahweh appeared in a dream to Yosef in Mitzrayim, saying, arise and take the young child and his mother and go into the land of Yasharal, for they are dead which sought the young child's life. And he arose and took the young child and his mother and came into the land of Yasharal. But when he heard that Archelaus did reign in Judea in the room of his father Herod, he was afraid to go there. Notwithstanding, being warned about Elohim in a dream, he turned aside into the parts of Galilee. And he came and dwelt in a city called Nazareth, that it might be fulfilled which was spoken by the prophets, he shall be called a Nazarene.
All right, so he shall be called a Nazarene. And Nazarene means those that guard the law. So it doesn't just necessarily mean that, you know, you from Nazareth, that's why you're called a Nazarene. The Nazarene were those people that guarded that law. That's the sect of the Nazarenes. And also, think about if he didn't listen to the angel and didn't go back to the land. Say, you know, I'm going to stay in Egypt, you know, where it's popping. It's cool. It's hard to find me here. I'm around black people. You know, this is where I want to be. But he had to go here. And where did Yahshua pick most of his disciples from? Out of Galilee. Right out of Galilee. So all these things are being done according to scripture, according to prophecy, and according to the map, the plan that Yahweh already has set out. So when you decide you're going to do what you want to do, you're putting a monkey wrench in the game. You're messing up the system.
Brother.
Go ahead.
I just wanted to also say that verse 20, when he spoke of when he had them and the law that came up, it's time for you can come back now because all the people that sought your life is dead. It's part of the law of the place of refuge. Mm-hmm. You know, when you did something or say something, you was accused of something, but you were honest and innocent to what you did, and so you wasn't found guilty, but yet they say you need to go to another state where we have this city of refuge so you can live. But don't come back until the people who accuse you are dead, or the judge, also the judge.
The high priest. When the
is
high
dead.
Priest was dead, that's right. When you come. You couldn't come back until
right.
the high
you couldn't
priest
come
was
back.
Dead.
You say, but don't come back because they kill you. Amen. We got,
yeah, you come back and they kill you, that's on you.
That's on you.
Right.
So I wanted to bring it up that's because they're showing, you know, that the people that sought your life, sought the Most High Son's life, was dealt with. So now everything is cool. You can do what you do your job. You can roam around. You can come out.
And brother, that what he brought up just now.
One second before we go, let's move on to Exodus chapter 3. Go ahead, bro.
Yeah, bring it. You know, going off what he mentioned a while ago, how Yahweh put it in His law for there to be a place of refuge for those who had committed a crime. Those who had transgressed the law, you know, those who had done something evil, Yahweh set aside places of refuge for them so that they can continue, although they were banished.
Joshua chapter 5. Joshua chapter 5. Let's get that one.
So, seeing that Yahweh makes provision, even for the sinners, we should be merciful to those that we know are outside, but we still be merciful, create a way where they can come back. Create a way where they can be restored. Yahweh always creates a way of restoration for those who have transgressed.
Right. Well, he always leaves a space for repentance. So you have to do the same thing when you deal with people. You can't put them in a corner where, you know, they can't repent. Because then your intent is to kill somebody, to judge somebody. Yahweh always leaves a space for repentance. So when you deal with people and you talk to them, leave a space for repentance.
Don't back him into a corner.
Mm-hmm. Now, when you exercising a demon out of somebody who's in this word, that's a different story.
Yeah, different story.
That's how Yahshua said, "Get away from me, Satan." You know, he's exercising that demon. That's mm-hmm. different. But you know, the heathen or the Gentile that does not understand, or your own brother or sister that has no understanding, no light in them, that's a different story. That's like a baby. That's a sperm.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you want to protect that, and you want to do the best you can. But at the same time, you don't want to make them feel comfortable in doing wickedness because that lake of fire ain't comfortable.
That's right.
Joshua chapter 5. And we're going to start this at verse 1.
And it came to pass when all the kings of the Amorites, which were on the side of Jordan, westward, and all the kings of the Canaanites, which were by the sea, heard that Yahweh had dried up the waters of Jordan from before the children of Yasharal until we were passed over, that their heart melted, neither was their spirit in them any more because of the children of Yasharal. At that time Yahweh said unto Yahshua, make you sharp knives, and circumcise again the children of Yasharal the second time.
Alright, so the children that grew up in the wilderness had not been circumcised, and now is the charge that they need to circumcise.
Yahweh said unto Yahshua, make you sharp knives and circumcise again the children of Yahshua the second time. So they're in the wilderness, they're trying to go into the land, they're trying to do what they got to do, and now they're being circumcised. That's a hard task to now turn around and grab all these children and children that grew up in the wilderness and get them circumcised. Yeah. That's a very hard deed to do. Go ahead. Yeah.
And circumcised the children, and Yahshua made him sharpen eyes and circumcised the children of Yasharal at the hill of foreskins.
So he did what he was supposed to do. He kept the instruction. Go ahead.
And this is the cause why Yahshua did circumcise all the people that came out of Mitzrayim that were males. Even all the men of war died in the wilderness by the way after they came out of Mitzrayim. Now, all the people that came out were circumcised, but all the people that were born in the wilderness by the way as they came forth out of Mitzrayim, them they had not circumcised. For the children of Yasharal walked 40 years in the wilderness till all the people that were men of war which came out of Mitzrayim were consumed because they obeyed not the voice of Yahweh, unto whom Yahweh swore that he would not show them the land which Yahweh swore unto their fathers that he would give us, a land that flows with milk and honey. And their children whom he raised up in their stead, them Yahshua circumcised, for they were circumcised, uncircumcised, because they had not circumcised them by the way. And it came to pass, when they had done circumcising all the people, that they abode in their places in the camp till they were whole. And Yahweh said unto Yahshua, this day have I rolled away the reproach of Mizraim from off you. Wherefore the name of the place is called Gilgal unto this day. And the children of Yasharal encamped in Gilgal and kept the Passover on the 14th day of the month at even in the plains of Jericho. And they did eat of the old corn of the land on the morrow after the Passover, unleavened cakes and parched corn in the selfsame day. And the manna ceased on the morrow after they had eaten of the old corn of the land. 12. Neither had the children of Yasharal manna any more, but did eat the fruit of the land of Canaan that year. And it came to pass when Yahshua was by Jericho that he lifted up his eyes and looked, and behold, there stood a man over against him with his sword drawn in his hand. And Yahshua went unto him and said unto him, are you for us or for our adversaries?
So he saw that angel, but that angel was near. So the same way that angel was near for Moshe, if he didn't go ahead and carry this deed out, because some of these people's 40 years old getting circumcised.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
If he didn't do that deed, it was an angel that wasn't that far away with a sword that could have killed him. And also, because they're keeping the law and they're doing Passover, there's angels in between you. His name is there. So you got to be careful how you act in the presence of the angel. But one thing he's doing is he's identifying that spirit right off. Hey, look, are you with us or against us? Let me know. I need to know what we're dealing with right here.
Yep.
So all spirits that come around ain't for you. That's ain't right. Trying to help you. Go ahead.
And he said, nay, but as a captain of the host of Yahweh am I now come. And Yahshua fell on his face to the earth and did worship and said unto him, what says my sovereign unto his servant? And the captain of Yahweh's host said unto Yahshua, loose your shoe from off your foot, for the place whereon you stand is holy ground.
All right.
And Yahshua did so.
So he had to, the angel's telling him how he needs to address himself. When you in the presence of Yahweh, you better take them shoes off. And we skipped Exodus chapter 3, the same thing was told to Moshe when an angel came in the presence.
Right.
Remove your shoe from off your foot, for the place you stand is holy ground. What makes it holy ground is wherever Yah puts his spirit. And that's why we remove our shoes when we invite the angel, his presence, in here, because Yahweh's name is now there.
Mm-hmm.
So in any scenario like that, that angel has the authority to slay you or make your life a miserable hell. If you decide you want to show up any kind of way, you're going to learn how to respect the king. Because if you're being prepared to be in the presence of Yah forever, how are you going to be you're not just gonna show up that day and know how to do that. You have to be trained during this grace period where you ain't gonna die right away if you do something wrong. When you get a little, where he might smite you or something, give you a problem, or make your life miserable. That way you learn how to sanctify yourself and how to appear before Yah. And this is what these offerings are for, and these appearances is for. Learn how to be Kodesh. So we're gonna go to Ephesians chapter 6. And if you go to Bereshit 32, you see how when Yaakov wrestled with that angel, once he understood that that was an angel of Yah coming before him, he wrestled, hey, I'm not leaving, letting you go until you bless me.
That's right.
Because if you were coming here to kill me, I'd be dead already.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So you here to bless me. Ephesians chapter 6, and let's start this at verse 10.
Finally, my brethren, be strong in the Master and in the power of his might. Put on the whole armor of Elohim that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. Mm-hmm. For we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. Wherefore, take unto you the whole armor of Elohim, that you may be able to withstand in the evil day, and having done all, to stand. Stand therefore, having your loins girt about with the truth, and having on the breastplate of righteousness, and your feet shod with the preparation of the good news of peace. Above all, taking the shield of faith, wherewith you shall abide to quench all the fiery darts of the wicked. And take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of Elohim. Praying always with all prayer and supplication in the Spirit, and watching thereunto with all perseverance and supplication for all saints.
So it's telling you how to equip yourself for a spiritual war. You can go ahead and get you a bulletproof vest and get you an M16 and get all that stuff. You ain't going to shoot a spirit with that. You might kill the host, but then he's going to leave and go find another host. Come kid, get the host that's right behind you, that cut your neck. So, at the end of the day, this is a spiritual battle, and we have to understand, again, this is why we don't hate the sinner, we hate the sin, because we are wrestling not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. And this is why these laws that are being passed, all these things to make things difficult, you, the changing of times, the calendar, the moving around of dates, all these things are angels that are above these people. So you have to first know how to identify an angel, how to identify what side he's on, and know what to do. When you're dealing with the angel of Yah, if he's trying to get you to keep these commandments, that's what you need to be trying to do. If he's trying to get you to go a direction, that's where you need to go with faith and favoring, because you'll understand, hey, look, I'm doing the best I can right now. I'm keeping these commandments. I'm repenting. I'm not perfect, but I'm trying. I'm giving a great attempt. So why is he going to send his angel to destroy me? He's going to send his angel to help keep me in the way, because I have faith in the Mashiach that he is going to send his comforter and guide me in the way. So, in understanding this spiritual wickedness in high places, we're going to see a situation here. Let's go to Daniel chapter 10, where we see an example of this spiritual wickedness in high places. Daniel chapter 10. Daniel chapter 10, and we're going to start that at verse 1.
In the third year, Cyrus, king of Persia, a thing was revealed unto Daniel, whose name was called Belteshazzar,
Belteshazzar. So his name, his Hebrew name was Daniel, but of course the Gentiles love to rename people, and they renamed him Belteshazzar to glorify their God. Mm-hmm. Go ahead.
And the thing was true, but the time appointed was long, and he understood the thing and had understanding of the vision.
And you see, they will go as far as to tell you, you know, his name is revealed unto Daniel, but his name is called Belteshazzar. You notice they don't say Yahshua, the son of Elohim, but he's called Jesus. Mm-hmm. They're not trying to give you that option. Mm-hmm. They're going to make you worship their God. Mm-hmm. Go ahead.
In those days, I, Daniel, was mourning 3 full weeks. I ate no pleasant bread, neither came flesh nor wine in my mouth, neither did I anoint myself at all, till three whole weeks were fulfilled. And in the 4th and 20th day of the first month, as I was by the side of the great river, which is Hiddekel.
All right, so let's look at it. In the 3rd year of Cyrus, king of Persia, then he prayed for 3 weeks straight. So that's at least 21 days. Mm-hmm. Then 3 days after that, in the 24th day of the first month, he was by the side of the great river, which is Hiddekel. So it's been almost close to 4 weeks, but 3 weeks he prayed straight. Go ahead.
Then I lifted up my eyes, and I looked, and behold, a certain man clothed in linen, whose loins were girded with fine gold of Uphaz. His body was like the beryl, and his face as the appearance of lightning, and his eyes as lamps of fire, and his arms and his feet like in color to polished brass, and the voice of his words like the voice of a multitude.
And what's interesting, there's so much description here of how these angels look when he took the appearance of man. Mm-hmm. And it's a melanin colors here. Mm-hmm. And when they show the newest movies, they have no problem showing you that these angels are so-called black folks. Mm-hmm. But then when it comes down to the Mashiach, when it comes down to Yah, then all of a sudden this is this Gentile, Euro-Gentile.
Mm-hmm. Right.
So what are they subliminally telling you? They're subliminally telling you that servants look like this, but the king looks like this. Go ahead, verse 7.
And I, Daniel, alone saw the vision, for the men that were with me saw not the vision, but a great quaking fell upon them, so that they fled to hide themselves. Therefore I was left alone and saw this great vision, and there remained no strength in me, for my comeliness was turned in me into corruption, and I retained no strength. Yet heard I the voice of his words, and when I heard the voice of his words, then was I in a deep sleep on my face, and my face toward the ground. And behold, my hand touched me, which set me upon my knees, and upon the palms of my hands. And he said unto me, O Daniel, the man greatly beloved, understand the words that I speak unto you, and stand upright, for unto you am I now sent. And when he had spoken this word unto me, I stood trembling. And then said he unto me, Fear not, Daniel, for from the first day that you did set your heart to understand and to chasten yourself before your Elohim, your words were heard, and I am come for your words.
So Daniel is mourning all this time, not only for himself, he's mourning for his people. And he's fasting, and he's chastening himself. So this is an example of what it takes when you want to save somebody else. When you want to try to save somebody else, there's going to be some affliction on your side that you're going to have to take to save somebody else. And that's the problem. We don't mind saving people as long as it doesn't inconvenience us. But we won't be a servant in this world. You're going to have to inconvenience yourself to try to save people. You're going to have to be uncomfortable. You're going to have to go places you don't want to go. And you're going to have to be chastened. Go ahead.
Verse 13. But the prince of the kingdom of Persia withstood me 1 and 20 days. But lo, Mikael, one of the chief princes, came to help me and remained there with the kings of Persia.
So the prince of the kingdom of Persia withstood me 21 days. So are they talking about the physical leader of the kingdom of Persia? He came there? Mm-hmm. No. How he going to fight an angel? It's talking about the spiritual wickedness in high places. Just like when they talk about the angel over Thyatira, the angel over Smyrna, the angel over... There's angels over these assemblies, mm-hmm. just like there's angels over these leaders, these world leaders. And that's why I said, look, don't be coming against these leaders like that. I put these leaders in place. Even if they're a vessel for honor, a vessel for dishonor, they serve a purpose. So it's not for you. This is beyond your pay grade. You keep the commandments. That's what you worry about. Stop worrying about Obama and all what he's doing. Somebody put him there. If he is doing wickedness, then he's going to reap wickedness. If he's doing righteousness, he's going to reap righteousness. That's not for you to sit there, because now you're speaking against Yah. Who allowed that to happen? Like, is Yah, how you going to allow this man to come in here and make all these laws for gay marriage and bombing all these people with drones? How could you do that? You pointing at the Father. But you do the math. He said 21 days he had to fight that dude. But from the first day, it was the 24th day now. So from the first day, he decided to afflict himself. His prayer was heard. But there's other angels that decided, I'm going to leave my state. I'm going to do what I want to do. I think Lucifer going to win in the end. I'm going to help him out. That are working against you. You can't fight that battle. You're not equipped to fight that battle. Go ahead, bro.
Now I have come to make you understand what shall befall your people in the latter days. For yet the vision is for many days. And when he had spoken such words unto me, I set my face toward the ground, and I became dumb. And behold, one like the similitude of the sons of men touched my lips. Then I opened my mouth and spoke, and said unto him that stood before me, O my sovereign, by the vision of my sorrows are turned against me, upon me, and I have retained no strength. For how can the servant of this my sovereign talk with this my sovereign? For as for me, straightway there remained no strength in me, neither is there breath left in me. Then there came again and touched me one like the appearance of man, and he strengthened me, and said, O man greatly beloved, fear not, peace be unto you, be strong, yea, be strong. And when he had spoken unto me, I was strengthened and said, let my master speak, for you have strengthened me. Then said he, knowest you why I have come unto you? And now will I return to fight with the prince of Persia. And when I am gone forth, lo, the prince of Grecia shall come. But I will show you that which is noted in the scripture of truth. And there is none that holds with me in these things but Mikael, your prince.
All right, so you have the prince of Persia. And then after that, he said, lo, the prince of Grecia shall come. So this is prophecy. All this stuff, this is from the time of Babylon and Chaldea. And all this time, these things are going to happen. So the fact that Obama is the leader of the soul, what they would call the free world, all this stuff is already ordained. You go in to try to vote and do all that, ain't going to mean a damn thing. It don't even mean a damn thing in the legal aspect of it, because the electoral college decide who they want to put their electoral votes. And there's no law or nothing in the Constitution that says the electoral college has to vote based upon your popular vote. It's called popular vote for a reason, because they want intel to know, if I put this guy in power that I'm trying to put in power, are these people going to revolt like they did in France and cut the king's head off? We need to know these things. Okay. They're not popular enough. That means I need to put more money into it. Or I need to pick a duck like McCain and Palin, some idiots that nobody will vote for, so that Obama can slide in. Let's move on. 2 Corinthians chapter 11. Let's hear the conclusion.
Seems like they decided to make this selection entertaining, since our people love entertainment.
Mm-hmm.
Get the court, pull the court jesters out. We want to laugh.
It's gonna be one on Twitter this year.
Let's put the jokes up.
2 Corinthians chapter 11.
Okay, thank you.
No problem, sister.
They turn it into loving hip hop Republican, right. Or something, you know, like
right.
Real congressmen of the GOP.
I, I just don't understand how this is even a option. It's really trying to expose how America truly is. Because how can the representation of your country, the woman aspect of it, be nude, be and exposed like that?
Wow.
So it's spiritual, you know, your wife, it's like Kanye West's wife being the first lady of the of the country. And she's a figurehead.
Of order.
Exactly. Yeah. So this that doesn't tell you that something spiritual is going on. The spirit of whoredom in America is being exposed.
That's right.
That it's even, that people are even considering this.
Part of the woman riding the beast.
Hmm. Yeah. 2 Corinthians chapter 11, and we're going to start this at verse 1.
I desire that you could bear with me a little in my folly, and indeed bear with me, for I am jealous over you with righteous jealousy. For I have espoused you to one husband, that I may present you as a chaste virgin to Mashiach. But I fear, lest by any means, as the serpent beguiled Eve through his subtlety, so your minds should be corrupted from the simplicity that is in Mashiach. For if he that comes preaches another Yahshua whom we have not preached, or if you receive another spirit which you have not received, or another good news which you have not accepted, you might well bear with him.
So bear with him. In other words, they come with this strange doctrine talking about beasts, to bear with them. Hey, look, listen, that's not true. Let me show you. Open up your book. Easter is not in here. Oh, it says Easter was, let's look at the Greek word, Pascha. Let's look at what Pascha is. There's the Hebrew root, Passover.
Please.
Has absolutely nothing to do with the Mashiach. Go ahead.
For I suppose I was not a whit behind the very chiefest apostles. But though I be rude in speech, yet not in knowledge, but we have been taught, we have been thoroughly made manifest among you in all things.
And now, rude in speech doesn't mean that he's you know, being disrespectful to people. He's not coming with all this fancy language. He's keeping it common. He's talking to people that don't have a lot of understanding, so he's keeping it common. Go ahead.
Have I committed an offense in abasing myself that you might be exalted, because I have preached to you the good news of Elohim freely? I robbed other assemblies, taking wages of them to do you service. And when I was present with you, I wanted
and wanted
and wanted, I was chargeable to no man. For that which was lacking to me, the brethren which came from Macedonia supplied. And in all things, I have kept myself from being burdensome to you, and so will I keep myself.
So you don't use your spirit as ransom, that, hey, look, I got the spirit, I got the word, I got the understanding, so I know you want it, so I'm going to make you pay for it. Mm-hmm. I'm going to make you exalt me and put me in all the great places, because I'm the one that has access to the word. That's what the assembly did. That's what the Catholic Church did. They raised themselves above. They had the book written, kept in Latin and Greek, knowing these people don't speak Latin and Greek, can't read.
Mm-hmm.
Instead of putting in a language that they could understand. So they abased themselves. And they put themselves with all this fancy clothing and all this gold and all this ritual stuff and doing all these things, and kept people from receiving a closer relationship with the Mashiach. You come to me and you tell me your sins, and I'll tell you what you need to do. Instead of telling how to have your prayers heard by the Most High. No. Just come to me. He's hearing me. I'll forgive you. Go ahead, brother.
As the truth of Mashiach is in me, no man shall stop me of this boasting in the regions of Achaia. Why? Because I love you not? Elohim knows. But what I do, that I will do, that I may cut off occasion from them which desire occasion, that wherein they glory, they may be found even as we. For such are false apostles, deceitful workers, transforming themselves into the apostles of Mashiach. And no marvel, for Satan himself is transformed into an angel of light. Mm-hmm. Therefore, It is no great thing if his ministers also be transformed as the ministers of righteousness, whose end shall be according to their works.
All right, we're going to stop there. So again, marvel not, for Satan himself transformed into an angel of light. So you can't trust every spirit that comes before you. But we were given the answer to that. Try the spirit by the spirit. And not to say, oh, we don't know that there's a spirit there. Yeah, there's a spirit there. But what spirit is it of? This is why you were given this book. This is why you were given a sword. Iron sharpens iron. So that you could learn how to discern spirits. Because just because something is spiritual that comes around you, don't mean it's for you.
Right.
Don't mean that it's going to help you. So that's all we're going to do today. Any last questions or comments before we close in prayer? All right. All brothers remove their head coverings and all sisters pray with their heads covered. And we face the east towards Jerusalem.
Okay.